Policing in Nigeria. They also want police officers responsible for beatings, killings, extortion, unlawful detention and other crimes to be held to account. So the protests continued and thousands of Nigerians, most of them under 30, took part in events such as peaceful marches, candlelit vigils, multi-faith prayer sessions. People came together across divides, having different social, cultural and tribal backgrounds. Supportive comments flowed in from the Nigerian diaspora around the world, from celebrities, and the End SARS movement quickly widened beyond the concerns expressed initially about policing and started to capture some of the general frustrations of a young population demanding an end to poor governance and corruption. But I'm afraid the situation became far more grave on 20th October when the Nigerian army and police opened fire on a peaceful demonstration at the Lekki toll gate in suburban Lagos. What happened is disputed, but Amnesty International have tracked events through photos and video footage posted by protesters. They show army trucks approaching the protesters from both sides of the toll gate, blocking them in. Shooting with live rounds started almost immediately with no warning given. A local musician, Obianuju Catherine Uday, was streaming the events live on Instagram as it happened, and later she said, "There was a guy that was running and he fell and we looked at him. He was shot in the back." Several people are now looking for missing loved ones, including Elisha Sunday Ibanga. An eyewitness told CNN that Elisha's brother Victor was shot in the head during the protest and his body was taken away.
I would also like to thank Silas Oja for creating this petition, which now has more than 220,000 signatures, including almost 2,000 of my own constituents in Edmonton who signed the petition we are debating today. And I'm sure that I'm not the only member to have been inundated with messages from constituents in recent months, urging them to do whatever they can to lend their voice to the End SARS protests. As the chair of the All Party Group for Nigeria, I was particularly keen to speak on this debate and highlight the need for the UK to stand with the Nigerian people against an increasingly cruel and brutal regime. The situation in Nigeria is incredibly serious, with tragedy after tragedy unfolding on the streets in state after state. As the Nigerian government and its security forces take ever more repressive measures to end a protest movement, which has given hope to millions across the globe. The End SARS movement is not just about disbanding the special anti-robbery squads. It is a movement led by the youth of Nigeria who took to the streets of Nigeria peacefully, demanding an end to brutality, extortion, and extrajudicial executions, and for a truly democratic Nigeria. The bravery of the youth-led movement will never be defeated. Today, we need to consider how the government should respond to both the movement itself and the violent actions of the Nigerian regime. However, we must also take this opportunity to look beyond sanctions to a way in which development funding is spent in Nigeria. Instead of funding corrupt security services and investing in projects which do not benefit ordinary Nigerians, we need a new focus on poverty relief and anti-corruption programs. Mr. Gray, it is vital that we recognise the role of the UK and how these events have unfolded in Nigeria. Despite previously stating the opposite, the government has now admitted to funding SARS units for the last 4 years. That funding not only included the provision of training to those units, but the supply of equipment. At the very moment in which Amnesty International had declared SARS units to have been involved in extrajudicial killings, corruption and torture, the government was using the aid budget to train and equip those units. In fact, between 2016 up to this year, more than 10 million went towards programmes from which SARS units benefited. That is not only immoral, it makes it harder for UK to play a positive role in Nigeria during this vital period. How can the government, with a straight face, call for an end to violence against protesters, having helped train and equip the security forces who are carrying out that violence? So today, I hope the minister will publicly apologise for the decision to fund SARS units and pledge a full and independent inquiry into this matter. Mr Gray, the 20th of October 2020 will be remembered as the Lekki Tollgate massacre, the day a deliberate and coldly calculated attack on peaceful Nigerian civilians was carried out by the Nigerian army. As I come to a close, it is time for the UK to change course and stand in solidarity with those fighting for a new Nigeria. Let's stand together. Let's get rid of corruption, extortion, extrajudicial murders and massacres, because it's time for a new Nigeria.
Thank you, Mr Gray. Before you speak, and I must say it's a pleasure to follow my honourable friend, the Honourable Lady for Edmonton, who speaks quite rightly with great passion about one of the great countries in this world that is sadly being racked by violence and violence against young people. Now, I would argue that the greatest book in the English language, and I know there may be some debate about this, but the greatest book in the English language is Things Fall Apart by Chinua Achebe, the great Nigerian writer. And the beauty of that book is the way it explains the challenge of changing generations to live together, and the way it speaks about values falling away and community being eroded by outside pressure. What we're seeing in Nigeria today is part of that story. It's a tragedy that we are watching. It's a tragedy that we are all witnessing, because as we see things falling apart, the pressure this time is not foreign colonialists have taken from the Nigerian people and hidden their ill-gotten gains here. We know that our banks, sadly, have been used for that profit and for that illegal transfer of assets.
Mr Gray, it's a pleasure to speak in this meaningful debate and to follow the Honourable Member for Tunbridge and Morling. The events surrounding the NSARS protest in Nigeria has caused global concern and outcry. Last month, mainly young Nigerian people took to the streets in a peaceful protest against police brutality. And on the 20th of October in Lagos and in other parts of the nation, the military are alleged to have attacked peaceful protesters with disproportionate force and have killed and injured civilians. The world watched the horrific videos. The world saw the awful pictures from the scene. The world heard the eyewitness accounts from survivors who managed to escape the horrors of that night. Human rights agencies such as Amnesty International have supported these claims. Despite the overwhelming evidence, Nigerian government and military initially denied that the military were at Lekki and labelled the events as fake news. Media companies received a memorandum from the Nigerian National Broadcasting Commission to silence them, not to embarrass individuals, organisations, government, cause disaffection or panic to the society at large, following reporting on the events of that dreadful night. Consequently, some media houses who did report on the events were fined. The bank accounts of some organisers involved in the protests have been frozen by the Central Nigerian Bank pending investigations. Some organisers involved in the protests have been arrested or harassed by the authorities. These actions equate to the preventing and indeed stopping free speech and the right to peaceful protest by the state, and this is unacceptable. Peaceful protests are vital to the functioning democracy and are a fundamental human right. These rights should be upheld and respected. Many of my constituents who have a Nigerian background are in great distress. Those that have relatives and friends in Nigeria are concerned about the safety of their loved ones and have contacted me about this situation. I indeed have close friends in Nigeria who are also deeply concerned and have contacted me about this. They all ask for one simple thing: that the UK government defends the right to peaceful protest and free speech and ensures that those within the Nigerian government and army are held to account for the atrocities committed against peaceful protesters. Given the dignity, must face sanctions.